In this tutorial, we'll discover how to find the average value of a function. Let's start off with an example. Suppose you have a car, and say it's cruising along at 20 miles an hour for an hour. On the graph of speed versus time, the speed is constant, 20 miles an hour, for the first hour. Then, after an hour, the car spends the next 2 hours going 50 miles an hour. First, what's the total distance that the car has traveled?
Let's look at each second of the trip individually. The first second of the trip is 1 hour long, and it travels 20 miles an hour for an hour. So the total distance traveled in the first part of the trip is 20 miles. The second part of the trip is 2 hours long. During that time, the car moves at 50 miles an hour. If it's traveling for 2 hours at 50 miles per hour, then it travels a total distance of 100 miles. So the sum of these two is 120 miles.
Nicely done. In the first hour, the car is traveling at 20 miles per hour for an hour. So the total distance traveled in the first hour is the speed multiplied by the time, which is the area under this portion of the curve. The hour up here cancels out the hour down here, meaning this first leg of the trip went for 20 times 1 miles. The second leg of the trip was at 50 miles per hour for 2 hours. So the area under this part of the curve is 50 times 2 miles. 20 times 1 is 20, and 50 times 2 is 100. So the total distance the car traveled is 120 miles. That means that the integral of this function is 120 miles. Next, what was the average speed of the car?
The car traveled a total distance of 120 miles. It took 3 hours total to travel that distance. So the average speed was 40 miles per hour.
Exactly. The car's average speed is the total distance it traveled, which was the integral of this function of 120 miles, divided by the total time the car was traveling, which was 3 hours. 120 miles divided by 3 hours is 40 miles per hour, which is over here on the vertical axis. Let's think a little more about what this average speed means. Suppose this car in blue travels like the blue function over here. It spends an hour, 2 miles per hour, and then 2 hours at 50. And suppose this purple car spends all 3 hours of the trip traveling at 40 miles per hour, the average speed of the blue car. Then the purple car travels at a constant speed, while the speed of the blue car changes over time. But both of these cars travel for 120 miles in exactly the same 3 hours. Now suppose you have a more complicated graph of speed versus time. For this graph, what is the total distance traveled between the second and ninth hours?
We saw before that the total distance traveled between two points in time, here 2 and 9, is given by the area under this curve, between 9. We can represent the area as an integral. We would take the integral between 2 and 9 of v of t dt.
Right. The distance traveled is the integral of this graph. You can write the total distance traveled between hours 2 and 9 as the integral of the speed v of t from t equals 2 to t equals 9. So what would you say is the average speed of this car between hours 2 and 9?
We know that the average speed can be computed by taking the total distance traveled and dividing it by the amount of time it took to travel that distance. We just computed the total distance here. It's this integral. All we have to do now is divide it by the time interval, which is given by 9 minus 2.
Precisely. The average speed is the total distance divided by the time it took to travel that distance, which was 9 minus 2, or 7, hours. Let's move the denominator out front. Now suppose instead of time and speed, we make this a generic variable, let's call it x. And suppose the vertical axis is f of x. And instead of 2 hours and 9 hours, we're looking at this function f between the points a and b. Can you come up with the general formula for finding the average value of a function between these two points?
We're not looking at speed and time anymore, but we can still apply the same idea. The average value would be equal to the total area under this curve between a and b, divided by the length of this interval. The total area is given by the interval of f of x dx, where x goes from a to b. Now all we have to do is divide by the length of this interval. What is that length?
Very well done. Here's the formula you came up with. The average value of this function f equals 1 over b minus a times the integral of f from a to b. For this function here, the height of this line represents the average value of the function. Let's consider the area under the average value. If we rearrange this equation you came up with by multiplying both sides by b minus a, we see that the average value of the function times b minus a equals the integral of f from a to b. This integral on the right side represents the area of the blue region under the curve. Meanwhile, the average value of f is the height of this rectangle, and b minus a is the width of the rectangle. In other words, the area of this purple rectangle equals the area under the curve. And that's another way to think about the average value of a function. It's the height of the rectangle whose area equals the area of the integral over the same region. Next, you'll get a chance to make your own function and see its average value. In this interactive, first you can make any function you want by editing this blue curve. The orange line here indicates the average value of your function, and the area of the rectangle underneath that line equals the blue area under the curve. Try making a function that's almost always larger than its average value.
The question says that we should make the function larger than the average value most of the time, but it doesn't say how much larger it has to be. In fact, it doesn't have to be that much larger. If you draw a function that looks flat like this, and then drops off really sharply toward the end, you'll see that the function is above the average most of the time, even if it's only a little higher than it.
So to recap, this is the formula we discovered for finding the average value of a function. Let's try an example with a quadratic function. Here's the function 3x squared plus 2x plus 1. Try finding the average value of this function between x equals 0 and x equals 2. For this sketch, the average value would be something like this, but you'll want to use this formula to find the exact answer.
Remember that if you have a function that looks like x to the n, an antiderivative is x to the n plus 1 divided by n plus 1. So an antiderivative of 3x squared is 3 times x cubed over 3, or x cubed. An antiderivative of 2x is 2 times x squared over 2, or x squared. And an antiderivative of 1 is x. Try using these antiderivatives to evaluate this integral. Here's an antiderivative of our function. To compute this integral, we have to evaluate it at a and b. Here, a is 0 and b is 2. The integral is equal to big F of 2 minus big F of 0. So let's evaluate this. Big F of 2 is 8 plus 4 plus 2. That's a total of 14. F of 0 is 0 plus 0 plus 0, which is 0. So this integral is equal to 14. And that's this part of the expression. So now what we have to do is take this 14 and divide it by b minus a.
Here you'll prove what's called the mean value theorem. Let's start off with any old function that's both continuous and smooth, like this one here. And now let's pick two points on the function. And here's the line that connects them, known as a secant line. Note that there's a point between these two with a tangent line that has the same slope as the secant line. Can you draw a smooth function connecting these points whose instantaneous slope is never equal to the slope of this secant line?
Let's look at the slope of the tangent line at this leftmost point. This slope is negative. On the rightmost point, this slope is positive. This means that no matter what happens to the function between these two points, the slope has to turn around eventually because it's a smooth function. So there will always be a point that has this slope.
Well, that's very interesting. For any smooth function you draw between these two points, the derivative of that function will equal the slope of the secant line somewhere between the points. Let's see if we can prove why that is. First, let's label the x-coordinates of these two points, a and b. And let's draw another function, which we'll call f. Then this point has a y-coordinate, f of a, and this point has a y-coordinate, f of b. Consider the derivative of f between points a and b. What would be an expression for the average value of the derivative between a and b?
We're not looking for the average value of f. We're looking for the average value of the derivative of f between a and b. That is, the average value of f prime of x. The average value between a and b of f prime of x is the integral of that between a and b, divided by the integral, which is b minus a.
Between a and b is equal to 1 over b minus a times the integral of the function from a to b. The derivative of f is a function, so you can plug f prime into this formula to find the average value of the derivative. So the average value of f prime is 1 over b minus a times the integral of f prime from a to b. Try evaluating this definite integral.
F prime of x is the derivative of f of x. That means that the antiderivative of f prime of x is just f of x. To evaluate the integral, we take the antiderivative, f of x, and evaluate it at b and a.
Good work. Let's see what you did with this integral. The antiderivative of f prime is f. So this definite integral is equal to f evaluated at the upper limit, b, minus f evaluated at the lower limit, a. So let's plug this back into our expression for the average value of f prime. And let's move this expression into the numerator of this fraction. Great. So you found that the average value of the derivative of f between the points a and b is equal to f of b minus f of a divided by b minus a. Now for a second question. What's the slope of this secant line?
The slope of any line is the change in y divided by the change in x. The change in y is f of b minus f of a. The change in x is this distance here, which is b minus a.
Okay. So it turns out that the average value of the derivative between the points a and b is equal to the slope of the secant line between a and b. That's pretty interesting. Next, you'll make your own function and explore when that function is equal to its average value. In this interactive, you can edit the blue function here. The orange line represents the average value of your function over this entire range. Notice that this function equals its average value over here. But does a continuous function always have to equal its average value somewhere? In other words, suppose x equals a over here, and x equals b over here, and the average value of the function is z. Then does there always have to exist a point in between A and B where the function equals Z?
This question is asking us whether any function we make, we're calling it f of x, must equal its average value somewhere. It doesn't matter where, and it can happen more than once, but it has to be somewhere. And we're going to call one of these points C. And the value of that point is f of C. It looks like no matter what we do, there's no way to escape the average value. If the function is higher than the average in most places, then there has to be some place where it's lower than the average. Since the function is continuous, that means that it must cross the horizontal line somewhere.
Okay, so you found that continuous functions must equal their average value at some point. This fact is known as the intermediate value theorem. If you apply the intermediate value theorem to f prime, it says that at some point between a and b, f prime must be equal to the average value of f prime. And let's call that point c. For the function we've drawn here, the c would be over here. This is where the derivative is equal to its average value, which is in turn equal to the slope of the secant line. So for smooth functions like this one, the derivative must be equal to the slope of the secant line somewhere between the two points that define the secant line. This fact is known as the mean value theorem, and you've just proven it. Now let's see the mean value theorem in action. You're driving a car down a highway with some traffic, and you see mile marker 105 at 7 o'clock. And then 2 hours later, you pass mile 185 at 9 o'clock. What speed or speeds must your speedometer have reported at some point during those 2 hours?
Let's first figure out what the average speed of the car was. If we started at mile marker 105 and ended at 185, then the total distance traveled was 80 miles, and the time that it took was 2 hours. So the average speed is equal to 80 miles divided by 2 hours, or 40 miles per hour. That means that the slope of this line is equal to 40. Now, that doesn't mean that the car had to be traveling at exactly 40 miles per hour the whole way. The path could have looked like this, or it could have looked like this. What does the mean value theorem tell us? We already figured out that the slope of this line is equal to 40 miles an hour. The mean value theorem says that no matter what this function looks like, as long as it's smooth, then somewhere along the path, the slope will be 40. But it doesn't say any more than that. The only thing it can guarantee is that the slope is 40 somewhere.
You've seen how you can use integrals to find areas between curves, but you can also use them to find the lengths of curves. Here's the parabola y equals x squared. Later on in this tutorial, we'll be finding the length of part of this curve. But let's start with something a little more straightforward, like a straight line. Suppose this line passes through the points 1, 2, and 8, 6. What's the length of the line segment between these points?
You can use the Pythagorean theorem to find the length of this line segment. Draw a right triangle here. This line segment is now the hypotenuse of this right triangle. The base of this triangle has length 7. The height of the triangle is 4. So the length of the hypotenuse is the square root of 7 squared plus 4 squared.
Exactly, and you used the Pythagorean theorem to find that answer. You can draw a right triangle here. The horizontal distance between these points is 7, and the vertical distance is 4. That means that the hypotenuse of this right triangle has a length equal to the square root of 7 squared plus 4 squared, which you found was approximately 8.062. So you can use the Pythagorean theorem to find the length of a straight line. Now let's return to a curve. Don't worry about precisely finding the length of this curve just yet. Instead, how might you approximate the length of this curve?
Since we know how to find length of line segments, we could try breaking this curve out into line segments. We could add up the length of this line segment, plus this line segment, plus this line segment. This won't give us the exact length of the curve, but it'll give us something close.
Yep. To find the length of a curve, we're going to break it into many small line segments. In this interactive, you can make any function you want in Blue. These orange line segments are used to approximate the length of the curve. If this small segment here has a width of dx and a height of dy, then what is an equation you can use to find its length, which we'll call ds?
Ds is the length of this small line segment. If we want to find its length, we can use the Pythagorean theorem again. Dx is the change in x, and dy is the change in y, and this is the right triangle. So use the Pythagorean theorem to get the right answer.
Exactly. So these orange line segments are used to approximate the length of the blue curve. The sum of the lengths of the line segments, each of which is calculated using the Pythagorean theorem, is shown over here. And the actual length of the blue curve is up here. How can you improve this approximation?
Right now we have a small number of line segments, and you can see that the approximation is pretty far off. Let's try using more and more points. Now, all of these line segments look much closer to the actual curve, and so the approximation is better too.
So to approximate the length of a curve, you can break it up into many small segments of length ds, which has a horizontal component of dx and a vertical component of dy. By applying the Pythagorean theorem, you found that ds equals the square root of dx squared plus dy squared. Adding up the lengths of these very small ds's gives you the length of the entire curve. Adding up all these tiny pieces is the same thing as taking an integral. So this is the expression for the length of a curve. Usually, we like to do integrals with a dx or a dy sitting out on the right. Try finding an equivalent way to write this integral on the right so that it has a dx sitting out here by itself.
We want to have a dx outside, so let's just put one there. Of course, if we multiply by dx, we have to divide by dx to keep the value the same. Now, we can distribute this 1 over dx into the square root. 1 over dx is actually the square root of 1 over dx squared. See if you can take it from here. If we distribute this 1 over dx squared term into this square root, we now have the square root of dx squared over dx squared plus dy squared over dx squared. This leaves us with the square root of 1 plus dy dx. All that squared, dx.
Precisely. You can multiply this expression inside the integral by dx and divide by dx, so that the value of this expression doesn't change. Then you brought the 1 over dx inside the square root, giving you the square root of 1 plus dy dx squared. And this is a formula you can use to find the length of a curve. Let's go back to that parabola from the beginning, y equals x squared. Using this formula, can you find an expression for the length of this curve between the origin and when x equals 2?
All we need to know is what dy dx is. Y is equal to x squared, and dy dx is the derivative of y with respect to x. So from the power rule, we know that dy dx is 2x. So this term is just 2x. Don't forget to square it.
Nicely done. First off, you found that the limits of this integral were 0 and 2. You also found an expression for dy dx, y equals x squared, and the derivative of x squared is 2x. Let's plug the 2x in for dy dx in this integral. The square of 2x is 4x squared, and this definite integral is the length of this curve here. Unfortunately, this integral turns out to be really hard to evaluate. You can do it with a Riemann approximation on a computer. So good job with that. Now let's go back to the integral we found for the length of a curve. For the parabola, you knew y as a function of x. But say you have parametric equations, meaning you know both x and y as functions of another variable, which we'll call t. How can you now rewrite this integral on the right so that it's an integral with respect to t?
We want to add a dt outside now, so let's put one there. If we do this, we have to multiply by 1 over dt, or the square root of 1 over dt squared. Next, distribute this 1 over dt squared term into this square root.
Well done. This time, you multiply the divided by dt. Then you moved the 1 over dt term into the square root, giving you the square root of dx dt squared plus dy dt squared. So when you have parametric equations, this is the formula you can use to find the length of a curve. Let's try another example. Suppose x equals r times the cosine of t, and y equals r times the sine of t, where r is a constant. Find the length of this parametric curve over the region from t equals 0 to t equals 2 pi.
Let's start by finding dx dt and dy dt. Dx dt is the derivative of x with respect to t, and that's equal to r times the negative sine of t, or minus r times the sine of t. Dy dt is the derivative of y with respect to t, and that's equal to r times the cosine of t. Plug these into the integral down here. Now that we've plugged in dx dt and dy dt, let's simplify the expression inside the square root. This is equal to r squared times sine squared t plus r squared times cosine squared t. Next, we can factor out the r squared, giving us sine squared t plus cosine squared t inside. But this is equal to 1. So this leaves us with the square root of r squared, or r. We just found that this entire expression inside here is simply equal to r, giving us the integral from 0 to 2 pi of r times dt. We can pull the r out of the integral, leaving us with r times the integral from 0 to 2 pi of dt. This expression now simplifies to r times 2 pi minus 0, or 2 pi r. Does this look familiar?
Good work. You got an answer of 2 pi r. Let's see if that answer makes sense. What does this parametric curve look like? When t equals 0, this curve starts on the x-axis and then circles all the way around until t equals 2 pi. Actually, this parametric curve is exactly a circle centered at the origin, and its radius is r. The length of this curve is the circumference of a circle of radius r, which you've just found is 2 pi r. And that's correct, so good work. So to summarize, you used the Pythagorean theorem to find two integral expressions that you can use to find the length of a curve. Use this expression when you can write y as a function of x, and use this expression for parametric equations.